The main character in this film is called Eric, and he's played by Steve Evets, who's sitting alongside me, and his will be the next voice you hear.
And I'm sat next to Ken Loach, the director of many great films, including this one, Looking for Eric. First scene, first day, my first scene. So I was quite nervous about the whole project because I didn't know what was going to happen. And what I didn't need was this, because on the first day, it didn't go to plan. Eric Bishop should have carried on driving around the roundabout and the police sealed it off, and one of them actually says maybe he's French, which was a nice little clue. But unfortunately, a stunt woman who showed off a little bit too much for my liking smashed head onto us while it had Ken in the back of the car and Carl, the focus puller, and Barry.
Fortunately, I was the only one who got a slight bruise, being the most dispensable.
But it wasn't a good start for me for the first day's filming. I felt like I was jinxed.
Yes. What time is it?
It's 4 in the morning.
4 o'clock.
Try and sleep.
Listen, I'm really sorry about all the fuss.
That's the lass who's in Raining Stones, isn't it?
Yes.
What's her name again?
That's Julie Brown, who I worked with quite a few years ago in a film called Raining Stones.
Going anywhere. It's all right.
Can you get me clothes,
please? Try and relax.
Can't
just
be late for work,
it.
Nurse.
It's okay.
I can't be late.
It's all right.
I can't be late for work, nurse.
It's okay.
Can you get me clothes, please?
You get to sleep. Get
I can't be late.
Shh.
Can't be late.
It's okay.
Oh, Lily, I'm
so sorry. Oh, poor Eric.
George Fenton, who did the music, we worked on this opening piece of music quite a lot because it's quite a just finding the right mood in the music was quite difficult, both to keep it minimal but also to be quite neutral.
And that's our first intro into Meatballs there. Meatballs has come to save the day for Eric.
From Polesman to Astronaut.
Played by John Henshaw.
Yeah, John Henshaw. I've known John over 20 years. It's funny because I think we just got our equity cards. We were doing kids shows in school halls and community centres and stuff like that, profit share theatres. All sorts, me and John, way back then.
I've had a word with him. They've got to make a report, but I don't think they're going to take it any further due to your psychological condition.
The screenplay came about in quite an unusual fashion. Eric Cantona, probably the most famous footballer of his generation, got in touch with us. We thought it was a joke, really, initially, and to see if we'd be interested in working on a film together. Paul and I are big football fans, and so, of course, we were delighted. But then there's a question of what film do you make? Because wanting to work with somebody isn't really a justification for making a film. And Eric's idea was that we should do something related to the fans and how his connection to the fans. He had one fan in particular in mind. Paul and I thought about it, and Paul tried to write a story around that, but it didn't quite work out. We couldn't quite find the tension within the dramatic development that would lead to. So really, Paul started with a blank sheet of paper, talked to Eric quite a lot, and the screenplay that came out. This is the screenplay and the film that came out of it. But it's about many things. It's about being a grandfather. It's about being not being the person that you hoped you would be at a certain age. It's about the complexities of family life. It's about how families fracture, the consequences of that. It's about being a teenager and growing up, and the dangers that are there if you're not academic or you're not in a family that's going to push you up into a certain profession. So it's about fractures, really, and about disappointments and trying to reassert who you are, finding your own dignity.
I love this sort of intro into Eric Bishop's chaotic lifestyle here. His house, complete mess, and the kids, stepkids, don't even seem to see him anymore. Just absolute complete doormat. We had good fun doing this one with the young lads in it.
Just leave me alone. I'm trying to sleep. You get up. Obviously, Jess. Not going to school if I'm in bed, am I? God, leave me alone. Right, well, I'll just clear up for you, shall I? Hey, don't want to just... You're in your bed. The fucking hell are you? What, Jess?
Will you sort this out? It's not bleeding DOS house, right?
Sick of it, I am.
What the... Who the fuck are you, you prick?
Pardon me?
Who the fuck are you?
Who the fuck am I? I'll tell you who the fuck I am. I'm fucking room service. Do you wish to register a fucking complaint?
That's it, let him have it. I think we'd done a couple of resets on that as well, didn't we, Ken? We had to get rid of all them feathers.
Yes, there was no shortcut to that. When the feathers were there, they had to be handpicked one by one.
Eric's den. I felt very at home out of that room by the end of it. I spent that much time in there, especially with Big Eric and stuff. It just became like it did become like a second home, like a little retreat in a den.
Have you ever had a shrink, Eric?
Yes, we reckon that Steve's character, Eric Bishop, had been was a lifelong fan of Manchester United, but like many people, finds it difficult to afford the entrance fee, the gate money now. So he sees it, if at all, he sees it in the pub. He was there at the time when Eric Cantona was there in the early mid-90s. I went to a game with Eric Cantona, and it was extraordinary, the affection that people still had for him. This was 12 years after he'd 12 years after he'd played, but the crowd were singing the songs even though he wasn't on the pitch. And then when he discovered he was actually in the ground, of course, it was the roof went off.
Yeah, it is unbelievable, because they even sing the songs at FC United, which is the breakaway rebels. Every match they're singing his name. It's incredible, really. I mean, not going to be singing Ronaldo's name this season, are they? Centre forward, that the world has ever seen. Cantona. And look at that, though. I mean, incredible.
I think he had the capacity to project his personality across the stadium, and I think that's what endeared him to people. He had a sense of his enjoyment and his presence there.
Yeah, it's like you say, Ken, if you can project that to 70,000 people, it's an incredible feat.
This, of course, is a post office, sorting office, the post office didn't give us any cooperation at all, really, which is a pity, since the postmen we portray are, by and large, pretty good people. But anyway, the post office bureaucracy in its wisdom decided to offer no cooperation at all. So this was a set designed by Fergus Clegg.
And here come the A-team now, led by Meatballs in their mission to cheer up Eric. It was hilarious when these lot got together, because most of them are stand-up comics on the circuit, so it was quip after quip after quip, and they were all trying to out-gag each other, and it's fantastic, really.
For just a little minute, you might learn so much. What Eric needs is laughter. He's got it in there. According to him, laughter is the best medicine.
Do you have to get permission off Paul McKenna for that?
He was very generous in his support.
If I was in Eric's shoes, I'd rather have a good fuck up, honest with you.
Is that you volunteering?
Volunteering, Jack.
Listen, what we're going to do is try and make Eric laugh. OK, one at a time. I'll go down there.
Yes, there's Greg Cook, Des Sharple, Smug Roberts, Johnny Travis there, and there's Justin Morehouse.
Mm. There's Wendy there on the right. She came to a few auditions when you first started auditioning people, Wendy.
And Mick Ferry at the back.
Yeah, the judge.
And standing next to Mick is Trevor Dwyer Lynch, who shares the same birthday as me, though I've got a few more years on the clock, I'm afraid, than Trevor.
Right. One monkey turns to the other monkey, yeah. And goes, ooh, ah, 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 like that,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
The other monkey turns to the other one and goes, put some cold water in, you daft cunt.
Smug, legendary on the Manchester circuit, is Smug.
Anyway, yeah, whatever. All
right.
Hey, you're a bit of crossbirds, aren't you?
Yeah,
all right. Yeah. Heavily laden postman.
How many letters?
A fucking big bag full.
Yeah.
Stand in front of your imaginary mirror.
You pared this one down a bit, didn't you, Ken?
I think on the DVD there's the longer version of this scene. They carried Paul's script on to even greater heights of comedy.
Have you ever had to have met them?
Eh?
Do you have to have met the person?
Well, you must have met him if they love you. Come on!
Is there any way we can prep to get...
You can fucking shut up for a start.
I'm here, I'm in front of a mirror.
Stand in front of a fucking imaginary mirror, right?
I am.
Think of someone who... This might be hard for you. Think of someone who loves you. And imagine viewing yourself through their eyes. It's fucking dead easy.
Smoke loves him.
No, come on, do it now. Come on. Then gently press the thumb of each...
I think one of John's qualities, shared by Steve, though I don't to embarrass him, is that he can be funny and serious at the same time. Doesn't have to change gear, so that you both smile at him, but also you can be touched by him, and I think that's very good in an actor.
What's best, in through the nose and out through the mouth, or in through the mouth and out through
just
the nose?
Just breathe. Oh.
Breathe through your arse, if you like. Just...
Yeah, because Justin, he changed his hero from Fidel Castro, and I think Meatball said, enter this person, and he said, I'm not entering Fidel Castro. I want to change it to Cheryl Crow. Cheryl Cole, that's right, yeah.
And you're breathing, and you're holding your finger near your thumb. Are we there?
Yeah.
We all there?
Yeah. Is this supposed to relax us?
Yes.
This better not be some kind of weird old cult thing.
Oh, can't you shut up for a minute?
Weird old cult thing? I'm not taking my pants off.
Shut up! Fucking concentrate, will you?
Just calm down, just...
Well, it's him, you fucking bat! I'm trying to talk to the unconscious mind, not the fucking brain dead. Right, you're breathing, your fingers, your fingers together.
And you got to remember now, all of us, we didn't know where the story was going, because we didn't have a script. We were fed bits in sequence, so... It was all a big mystery to us what was going to happen throughout it. So it was a guessing game every day, and it was quite an adventure, really. It was a great way of working, because Well, it was exciting, and you were in at the deep end.
Smug, who have you thought of?
So you'd kind of go home and think, well, what's going to happen, you know?
Sammy Davis Jr.
For his confidence.
Smug is looking through the eyes of Sammy Davis Jr. Well, he's looking through one of them. Sammy Davis Jr. Spleen.
Fidel Castro.
Okay. Fidel Castro. Jack?
Nelson Mandela.
It's funny, I don't think I've ever known a crew so completely collapsed with laughter.
Yeah, when, it was hilarious, wasn't it?
When we were doing the scene. I mean, it doesn't... The thing is, if the crew laughs, it doesn't necessarily mean it'll be funny when you put it together. And I was really quite worried because I thought, well, it struck us as funny when we were doing it, but it doesn't necessarily translate to a comic scene. But playing it to audiences, this does seem to work.
Yeah, a lot of people like this scene.
I'm going to emulate Frank Sinatra. Hey, we could do a duet. Right, what a room we've got here. What a fantastic room. Sammy Davis Jr., Fidel Castro, Gandhi, Nelson Mandela, Eric Cantona, and old Blue Eyes himself, Mr. Frank Sinatra. Hey, what a year that was.
We got all the Winnie now.
I need to see Winnie. Winnie.
Yeah, I can't finish off over here, mate, Balls.
Eric, what's this, mate?
Fucking my letters, do you mind?
Have you not opened them? Are they yours, Eric? Is that built?
What's them? What are you looking at me letters for? Do you put them down, please? Come and sit down. Eric. Let's carry on with this exercise. Jack, what are you doing, for fuck's sake?
Are they yours? Have you not opened them? Isn't that built?
Whoa!
Oh, Arthur, crying out, bleeding now.
Eric.
What's this, Eric?
Eric, what's going on, mate?
Arthur, crying out loud. Please get on the phone and tell the lads we're going to have to deliver these tomorrow.
Yeah, this is where it all started going strange. That was Jed there out of Jed Kearns out of Shameless. Who's this fabulous thing? Well, it's a really good strong cast anyway, but Jed's got such a presence about him.
This was a really critical scene to shoot because Eric is talking to his hero, Eric Cantona, to his poster, and trying to emulate him according to Meatball's instructions.
Which, and at that time, I didn't know Eric was going to be in the film, so... I was totally oblivious to what was going to happen next.
And I think surprise is actually one of the hardest things to act. If you know something's going to happen beforehand, you have to generate that feeling of surprise. So we always try and make it work so that you can actually film the surprise in the person's eyes.
Well, it worked. But we couldn't use the first take because I wouldn't turn around. I thought it was one of the Belgian lads in the crew. I thought he was feeding me some lines, so I carried on improvising with the post on. But the shock is so much, you carry it with you for a long, long time. So it's easy to tap into it again.
I've never done anything that you're ashamed of.
And this is like the moment before the moment.
Well, have you?
I'll never forget the feeling.
Fucking hell. What the fuck?
Yeah, so to try and make it work, we made We asked Steve to leave the room for a few minutes so that we could rejig the lighting, and we built a little black hide around the camera, which Eric was in the next room, Big Eric, as we called him. He was in the next room and came into the room while Steve had nipped out for a fag. And then at the appropriate moment, he stepped out and... there he was.
It's amazing because our Ken's crew as well have these little earpieces in, like the Secret Service, so you never hear any radios. If you're in the van or getting driven somewhere, you never heard any voices over the radio. You never see a call sheet. I found an old one once and it had in block capitals, do not leave any schedules, call sheets or script lying around where the cast might see them.
Oh, it's fucking Lily.
Open the trunk.
So this was bizarre now, to be doing a scene that was all written by Paul Laviter. I think it was after dinner, after I'd met him. It was incredible. I was eating lunch, reading it.
I think we did the first few lines and then we reconvened the next day.
Right.
Once you'd had the script.
It was such a mad experience.
The idea of having an imaginary character in it, or a character who lives only the imagination of someone else, was really quite a difficult thing to work out, really. And I mean, they're all kind of cliches just waiting to happen, you know, the sort of wavy lines or people appearing through smoke or out of animated pictures. And we thought we wouldn't do any of that. We'd just try to do it very simply. So he's there when Eric sees him and he isn't otherwise. And the criterion that we used and that Paul used in the writing was that everything Eric says, someone who'd read so much about him as Steve's Eric, would be able to deduce.
You know, sometimes beautiful memories are plus difficile à supporter.
But, I mean, it's a comedy, so there's a little license here and there.
Yeah. The hardest to deal with.
I took a photo of him that day and on my phone and sent it a mate of mine and told him what was going on. And he just accused me of being at Madame Tussauds.
It's a daft idea, really. The compere, he pulled out these tickets at random from these boxes, one for the girls and one for the boys.
And I'd learnt this scene without Eric's bit had all been cut out.
Number 19, Eric.
And we were actually at this flashback, which was a great idea because me and Stephanie, who plays Lily in it, we're at this flashback, so it was like we had the memories of how we met in our head, which was invaluable later on when you come to talk about it in the film. You feel like you were there and it was part of your living memory.
Absolutely fucking God.
We were very lucky. We found a really nice young Eric and young Lily, and they played really well together.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the Emperors of Rhythm. Famous rock band.
Yeah.
Who I think had lived through most of it. they certainly created a really good atmosphere.
And young Eric there, Michael McNulty, I played his dad in See No Evil about the Moors murders. I played Jack Smith, he played David Smith. So it was quite funny when he got cast as the younger me. We had a bit of a good laugh about that.
What a dance, I couldn't believe it. She left me standing. I was like, God, what's going on here? But the second number was It's Late by Ricky Nelson. I was ready for her then. Band start playing, I'll tell you what, I was chucking her about, flipping her and tossing her everywhere. She just kept coming back faster than ever. It's like she fucking trusted me, you know what I mean?
Should have left over about a quarter to nine. Beat a head phone and plenty of time. We got started just a little bit late, but this won't be our last day. it's on to me, it's late.
It's late.
You gotta face your dead, I know.
I know.
I know it's gonna be mad, it's late.
It's late.
You gotta get on home, it's late. We've been gone too long.
They're always great fun to cut those scenes. To music, and I think Jonathan Morris, the editor, really enjoyed making the dancing sequence work.
I just brought us closer together, but it's just like one of those magic nights that you know you're never going to have again.
And it's great, them two, their chemistry there, it's fantastic, I think.
I've never done that with anyone else, except Lily Devine.
And such years later, you can even face her. Incroyable, no?
Well, a lot of mistakes have been made. A lot of water under the bridge. Can you imagine being asked by your daughter to meet your ex-wife on a daily basis when you've hardly seen her for 3 decades?
Well, I've just a few weeks till graduation and...
This is Lucy Jo Hudson, who I think is the only member of the cast who initially comes from a little way out of the city. I think she's lived in Manchester quite a long time.
Yeah, she's got a bit of a Yorkshire twang in there, hasn't she?
There has. I mean...
She's just got married recently as well. We went to a wedding do, me and my daughters. That was good. But she's great, Lucy Jo, yeah. Is she from Leeds, as you can?
No, I didn't spot it, I'm afraid.
No.
But, I mean, I think it's very important people come from the place they're supposed to come from. But anyway, she does very well.
Her mum's?
Oh, for God's sake, Sam. I've hardly seen your mother for years. Most of your lives, for Christ's sake. Don't ask
Dad.
Me to do that, love. I can't. Not now. It's just...
You've both moved on. It doesn't make sense anymore.
I think what was good in Paul's script is that both the women in the film are quite strong characters. I mean, the character that Lucy Jo plays was brought up in a one-parent family. She's... had a relationship early, didn't work out, she's got a child, but she's obviously done a variety of dead-end jobs, but has now got herself to college and is going to get a degree. And whether or not she can get the degree is one of the themes running through the film. But I think we were quite pleased to write a character who... or to have a character that was quite positive. You know, I mean, when people are not rich, you don't. Not every character is a victim.
Everything.
And this is Eric's first wife, Lily, played by Stephanie Bishop, who again is someone who's really made something of her from a life starting from a disadvantaged point of view with an early marriage that breaks up. Single mum, and she kind of gets her life together.
I'm fucked.
Unlike Eric.
Yeah, it's funny how the two women are sensible ones who've bettered themselves against the odds, really.
A jump of the nearest block of flats.
Well, it's all right for you, flawed genius bastard. Playing beach football, VIP, celebrity pals. You've even got a fucking French accent. Eh? Look at me. Scrawny little fuck. You got it all, mate. All of it.
You think my friends are better than yours?
It's all just slipping through my fingers. The lads look through me. And I can't even trust myself. I feel like I'm floating and I'm looking down on myself, wondering...
Eric
like
wallowing in self-pity.
You can anticipate all the dangers. Ne prendra jamais la mer.
Oh,
is that forecasts? All perils will never sail the seas. Is that is afraid to shake the dice will never throw six. If you do not enter a tiger's den, you cannot
I'll
get his
cup. Sting you with proverbs up your fucking ass! How do you say that in French?
C'est pas gentil, ça.
Hein?
That's not very nice.
I'm fucking up to here with your philosophy. I'm still getting over the fucking seagulls one, for Christ's sakes.
Always got mojo season, we think. Always.
You like what?
A shave.
Big Eric's presence is just fantastic.
You can't face it, right?
Yes, you can. Right?
Yeah, smartened up a bit.
Well, a bit.
Yeah, a little bit, but it's a start. It's a start. And Lily looking great. It was funny as well with the two babies, wasn't it, sometimes? Because we had two babies playing one baby. So when one started crying, it was like, baby B, please.
No. Lily. Your first one.
Yeah. Another one of Ken's little jokes there. When you go up to her, say Chrissy. Don't say Lily.
Well, it was Paul's joke, actually.
Well, Paul's, but yeah. It's nice to see that little sort of thing on her face. Which, what?
Yes, we...
a few of them went in.
Yes.
Are you OK, Eric?
Yeah, fine. I'm sorry about the other day. It's just that I had a bit of a dizzy spell. I haven't slept right. But yeah, I'm fine. Fighting fit.
Good. So are you okay for dropping her at my place later, or would you rather meet back here?
Whatever's easiest. Like, it's only 6 weeks, isn't it?
Yeah.
No, I didn't mean it like that. Fancy a cup of tea, Lily?
Why? Look, Eric. Let's just try and get through this the best we can for Sam.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I'll see you later, Eric.
OK. See ya.
Bye-bye, gorgeous.
Hello.
Oh, just what we've always wanted.
Ryan, can I have a word, please?
Peter!
Ryan, what the fuck is that out there?
Just a rough guess, but it looks like a cement mixer.
Yeah, I can see it's a cement mixer, Ryan. What the fuck is it doing there?
It's just chilling there for a bit.
Well, do you think it is a fucking goat cart?
Yeah, it's having a bud.
Oh, you've nicked it, haven't you, hey?
Who's nicked it?
You've nicked it.
It's a bit strong.
Well, where's it come from? You've nicked it.
Right, well, I'll get it sorted.
You will get it shifted now, please.
Well, I'll do it when I can.
Hey?
Yeah.
Hang on a minute, where are you going?
Going to the match. You're not coming, Eric.
Again, I mean, it's one of the ironies of the film that Dad can't afford to go, but the lads are up to no good, probably making more money than he is, and they've got friends who can get them into the game.
Yeah, that's the first time we see Zach as well, isn't it?
Our sort of
villain.
Zach's doing the driving.
Nasty piece of work is that. Played greatly by Steve Marsh. He's in a Big Cook, Little Cook thing. He does a kids' programme. There's all sorts of stuff around the house.
Fucking hell! Oh, shit! Fucking work coat! Bastard! Oh, for fuck's sake! Fucking hell! Fuck, fucking hell! Go. Jack Bishop. Ironmonger.
A manga? In Kinkaye?
Yeah.
Your father. Why are you close?
Well, he sat on me by mistake once. She sent me this a week after I left her.
can't love you any more than this, Lily.
I never ever answered her. The longer I left it, the worse it was. And then it was just no going back.
So tell us the truth.
What can you say to someone who's just laid their heart out on a plate? It's just like there.
I think there was a lot cut out of that, wasn't there, about the dad, you know, taking the mickey out of him when he was dancing, when he was younger. And
yes.
When the dad went to bed, him and his mum used to dance and stuff like that.
Yeah.
No way, I'm going to get through this. I can't meet her every day. I'll just end up back at that fucking roundabout going round.
You must speak to her.
We found we had to shoot the scenes in this room very simply. Shooting in a restricted place can lead you to use kind of a lens that makes it really look ugly, or that is too wide because you want it wider. So you use a wide lens, which can make the room look ugly and the people look ugly. So we tended to shoot it very simply from two basic positions, and just hope that the movement gave enough sense of the room.
All right!
Yeah, I've got to say, the FC United lads, when they saw this scene, and it were over the moon that, well, first of all, that their team got a mention, and it was they were so chuffed.
At the bar is an actor and a comedian I worked with before called Ven Tracy, who's played a big part in a film we did called The Navigators. Very good comic.
You can change your wife, change your politics, change your religion, but never, never can you change your favourite football team.
The author he's quoting is Eduardo Galeano, but might have been a bit of a mouthful to say. Famous writer who from Latin America wrote a celebrated book called The Open Veins of Latin America.
No, it's still there. Still there. It's all in the art. It's still there.
We'll never die, pals.
Yeah. He never fucking goes, George, anyway. What are you talking about?
You mean, I've told him there's no secret of facts. I can't afford it. I can't afford to set the kids.
Exactly. That's the point, isn't it, you daft git?
Car parks don't lie. You have a look. Have a look now. What kind of car parks in there?
I think what's happened to the Premiership, where it's the business side of it has become so massive, and the amounts of money are so huge, that it has attracted investors and to buy the clubs and very wealthy people who are not basically football people, then buy the club, and the supporters really have no say or very little say in the club's direction. And I think that's a great pity. It doesn't apply, obviously, to clubs outside the Premier League, or not so much. The lower levels, many clubs are just that. They're groups of people clubbing together. But for the big clubs, they become like corporations. Although Eric Cantona himself was very eager to point out the difference between the footballing side, where the football can be brilliant and beautifully played, but nevertheless the capitalist side of it is can take the club away from the people who have supported it all their lives.
There's that second encounter with Zach.
Mm-hmm. On that earlier point about the business side of football, we talked a lot to David Conn, the journalist and author who's written extensively on how football has developed, and I think has some very pertinent things to say. Yes, but here Eric has seen his son Ryan get into trouble, and Ryan is obviously into things that are into really deep waters. And it's interesting, this conversation, because it shows that there was a when Ryan was younger and the boys were younger, they had quite a good relationship with their stepdad. But obviously, as teenagers grow up, you know, you have to. It's inevitable you reject the people around, the older people around you. So there is that dislocation in their relationship now.
Mm.
And while Eric is trying to reach out to him, Ryan thinks he knows too much to involve Eric. And the Eric in front of him is a complete failure.
Yeah.
So why should Ryan take any notes of what he says?
Absolutely. There's no respect there whatsoever.
Nothing? Good? Good to me?
Yeah, so good he gives you a smack, eh? Is that what friends do these days?
You don't even know him.
But yeah, it is nice how Eric's just trying to reach out there and he's just getting nowhere.
Look, Ryan, I want to help, mate. You can't go on like this.
What are you going to do, Eric?
I mean, it's just so dismissive. I mean, what are you going to do and just walk off? It's... And then there's Jess and his mates. They don't even see him.
Jess, come on, I've got work tomorrow and you've got school. Let's wrap it up, eh?
Give him a black on me.
5 more minutes, and that's it, yeah.
And it's funny, Eric Bishop's trying to be authoritative and it's just not a hint of it in his voice or his body language.
Jess is played by Stefan Gums, who we auditioned a lot of kids, and Stefan really stood out, having a really warm personality, but a lot of mischief about him.
Yeah, he's a good lad.
You must say no.
Again, we had to smuggle Eric into that scene.
That was another one.
That's a genuine surprise.
Yeah, that was just wash a few dishes and then get some off the table. Oh, there he is again. A lot of people like this scene. It's just one of my daughter's favourite scenes. She just loves this with the nose building up to a mad crescendo and then the lads come down.
Yeah, mind you, I think it's a serious point for a number of parents.
Yeah, just say no.
No!
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 We should say it to our politicians once or twice as well.
Well, that'd be nice.
No!
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 I like the way that little bit of music comes in then as well to give it a bit more rhythm.
No! 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 No!
Dad? Are you all right?
No.
Now, this was good fun as well, talking about the goals here. There were DVDs of Eric's goals that I was watching for a long time. And, you know, yeah, they got ingrained on your mind. It was great to be able to just talk to him about them.
He bangs it over. You're there waiting. Bang!
Even though he doesn't remember.
Oh, Man City. Hughes down the right wing to Kinchelsis. Kinchelsis chips it over. You're there waiting. Bang! Casualties like straight in.
I think he does remember them in real life.
Oh, of course, yeah, of course. Well, that's what I mean. It's so good for Eric Bishop. Frustrating that in this, he doesn't always... Nah, forgot it, gone. Not important.
Give me strength.
Yeah, but yeah, Eric Bishop thrived on them.
Morning, Eric.
Morning, love.
Is the list working?
No, knackered again, I'm afraid.
Third time this week.
Must have been amazing, though. 60,000 people watching you, cheering.
This scene is very much based on Paul's conversation with Eric and his feelings about playing.
I love to surprise you.
And I think it is quite revealing about Eric.
In every game, I try to offer them a gift. Sometimes it didn't work, but then when it did...
In our minds forever.
Yeah. But I had to surprise myself first. Take a risk. You know, it depends on the limit you set yourself. Play safe. No risk. No.
to Sunderland.
It's great, that music coming in as well. It so works with it.
It was like a ballet.
Beautiful.
Yes, George's music here, being a supportive United, George Fenton took great delight in writing an anthem for Eric.
I've seen the video of it as well, with all the band with masks on, wearing their own football colours. It's great. It's proper stirring stuff. Look at that. I mean...
I think what people enjoyed, apart from the goal, was just the sheer audacity and the invention of not blasting it, but the delicacy of the chip.
Yeah.
Scream, laugh.
Even cry.
Yeah.
And the Englishman kiss.
But I mean, where else can you sing at the top of your voice with all your mates?
I just love the whole surreal quality of walking along a block of flats in Hume with Eric Cantona delivering letters. Look at that.
All right, sweetest moment ever.
This is true as well, isn't it?
It wasn't a goal.
It's got to be a goal, Eric. Come on, last minute, FA Cup final against Liverpool. Beckham takes a corner. The goalie runs out, he punches it away. It hits your chest, hits the floor on its way up. Bang, you smack it right in the net.
No.
Wimbledon, it's got to be Wimbledon. You're going towards the ball's coming in, you're sussing out the trajectory of it, the angle of it, the spin on it, the way the wind's blowing, the speed of the wind, everything. You stick your right foot out, you stop it in mid-flight, it bounces up about a foot off your leg, you come back, you whack it in, the most perfect volley in the world, in it goes, it's a goal, it's got to be a goal, at it.
It was a pass.
A pass?
Yeah.
My God. To Irwin against Spurs, yes! Beautiful!
I know how clever he was, left, right-footed. Came in a front,
yeah, just picked it up.
Surprised everyone. He took it in his stride and my heart soared.
A gift?
Yeah, like an offering to the great god of football.
What if it had missed?
You have to trust your teammates, always. If not, we are lost.
It must have been tough on you when you got banned. 9 months, the bastards. That twat got what he deserved.
I had to work hard, you know, dig deep inside.
I think Eric said this was his favourite scene at one Q&A.
Yes.
It's funny, isn't it? Sometimes we forget that you're just a man.
I'm not a man. I am Cantona.
Killer line. There's T-shirts of it now, you know.
Yeah.
So what did you do to keep yourself going?
Yes, I've heard that line repeated more than once.
It's going to go down with the make you an offer he can't refuse. I got a text from Stephanie the other week saying Stockport Market was full of these T-shirts. With
right.
I'm not a man, I am Cantona.
This is Eric playing the trumpet.
Yeah.
When we were recording the music, I sent Eric a text saying the musicians admire your playing, but they suggest you don't give up the football. He sent a text back saying, well, maybe they're afraid I'll take their work.
Nice shot of the kids there. There's a future of them.
I'm sorry about this. I'm sorry to just call on you like this, but your mobile switched off. My mum's had a bit of a fall and I'm going to have to whip her up to A&E. Can you take Daisy for a couple of hours? Just for a couple of hours while I get her up there?
Yeah, of course.
Can you grab the pan?
Yeah, sorry, I'm just making tea. Come straight through to the kitchen. I'm not tidied up in there yet, Laurie. Just come straight through.
So, but they're on holiday, Eric. Oh, you sacked him.
Well, you know how it is with two teenage lads. I'll make a start on it anyway. Hey, hello, baby. No.
Someone's going to have to find somebody else.
Lily? Stop. Lily, don't run off like this, Lily.
Oh, dear.
Lily, wait! Jess! Jess!
What, man?
Come here! Where's your bike? Right, listen, look after Daisy for me for a while, right?
What do you mean?
Just Dad, look after her.
Dad, I can't look after a baby.
Yeah, well, learn.
Dad, I don't know how to. What do we do? She's crying, Dad.
She's crying. How do I turn it off?
Yeah, so Lily's really got her life together. I mean, she's got a nice little house and a pleasant little terrace. Getting involved with Eric again is going to be a risky business, really.
And look at her now, she's already in bits. And
how's your mum?
She's fantastic, Steph. She really...
Yes, she...
She just radiates this gentleness and charm and naivety in a way.
Yes, well, she just played it dead straight, which was very good.
Explain. I was just 21, Eric. I had your baby. I loved you to absolute pieces. You walked out on me. Never come back. You left me to raise a child on my own.
You tell him, girl.
Do you want me to explain how I cried myself to sleep every night? How I fell apart and I had to rebuild my life? Just go, Eric Bishop. Because I don't care.
That was lovely, that, from Steph, yeah.
She hates you, right? Now we are going somewhere.
Well, we're going nowhere. I mean, she's right, I've totally flipped. We're both fucking grandparents.
La plus noble des vengeances, c'est de pardonner.
What?
La plus noble des vengeances, c'est de pardonner.
Look, I'm getting a bit fed up with all this bullshit, right?
Okay. I don't translate.
Oh, that's fine with me.
I kept corpsing at this part. It just made me laugh so much, Eric, the way he just sat there like that.
Oh, fuck it. What does it mean?
No.
Oh, come on, tell us. No. Oh, look, you can't just say it and then just forget about it like that.
I will not be a burden.
Oh, you're not a burden, mate. You know that. You're welcome here any time. There's no way you're a burden. Just tell us what it means.
The noblest vengeance is to forgive.
She might forgive me. Shit, it's Lily. Meet me in the pub. You know which one? Now. Fucking hell.
I told you.
Hi, Lily. Would you like a drink?
Just half a cider.
Okay. Can I have a half a cider, please?
So this is really when the background to what happened between Lily and Eric really starts to unravel.
Yeah, we get another flashback here, don't we? Which we were both at again, the christening with Maxton Beasley as the dad. He was great. He was very menacing, and just watching and listening to him, it made me hate him.
Just tell me, Eric, I need to hear this. Just tell me.
It was a balance, because we, on the one hand, we didn't want to say too much because it would just become predictable. But on the other hand, just to give enough of an insight into what had gone wrong between them, particularly what had gone wrong for Eric. So that it made sense, but without spelling it out in too much detail, which could be tedious. But Paul, when he was a researcher, did quite a lot of research into people who have panic attacks, whose mental state can be quite fragile, particularly in late adolescence, or which is, you know, when the critical years seem to be.
I love the way he's got hold of young Eric's neck there. It's very, if you do that to someone, it's so much like bullying and assault. It's really intimidating.
And he started prodding me with that stubby little fucking finger of his. I felt like I was floating off. It was like I was coming out of my own body.
And again, that was why it's so good for us to be sat there watching that, because when Eric Bishop's talking about it, it's there in his mind.
In slow motion.
Hey, where you going?
It was a panic attack, Eric. They're more common than you think. I mean, we come across it more or less all the time at the clinic.
I didn't know what it was. About half an hour later, when I calmed down, I came back. I came in and I just put an act on. And you know what? I've been doing that ever since, putting an act on.
But why couldn't you tell me?
I just blanked it out, even from myself. I was terrified. I thought I was going fucking bats like my Uncle Michael. Later on, I see you feeding Sam. And I don't know, I can't explain it, but I just couldn't handle it. I just couldn't handle it. It freaked me out. And then it got to the problem where I was scared of going home. Scared of going back to my own gaff.
I just thought he'd gone cold. Regretted the baby.
Wait.
I just wanted you to touch me, Eric. I felt fat, ugly, my clothes always stinking of milk. I remember I heard right, don't you, didn't I?
Oh, God, yeah.
Didn't know I could scream like that.
Neither did I. Mind you, I don't blame you. Staying out, getting drunk, off with the lads all the time. Excuses.
All the lies you told.
No. It's not so much the fact that I left you, which I did, I held my hands up. I just couldn't get back.
One thing about being grandparents is that whatever's happened to past relationships, the grandchildren, or children, but grandchildren in this case, ensure that you do keep contact. So in this case, there was always the possibility of a reconnection between Lily and Eric because of the grandchild.
Here's all the FC United lads off to the match. I'm just seeing Vinny lurking in the gate there of one of the pubs.
Yes.
Vinny Thompson from FC. I don't know what his capacity is there, but he's involved in everything in there. There he is, there walking behind Vinny and his mate Mike.
Hey, get in there, mate. Eric's meeting Lily.
Shut up.
You see, he could play Frank Sinatra in another life, couldn't he really?
Could do,
you can see it there. You can see it in his singing. Old blue eyes.
You know what, Lily?
I'll always be grateful that you never turned her against me, you know.
To be honest, it hurt that she had so much fun with you. It just didn't seem fair somehow.
Well, you got all the crap, didn't you? Homework, complaints. I just took her to see Cantona.
Yes and no. You know something, I was so furious with you at first. And then I got to thinking, my God, what that man is missing.
She's just so gentle and natural, isn't she?
Yes, and I think that thought is something that women particularly might identify with, because although they do by and large carry the burden of bringing up kids, seeing a child develop is a real gift in a way from, and fathers often miss that whether they're present or not.
Mm. I sat about 6 inches away from her. I just wanted to put my arms out of her, and I couldn't.
When you have learned how to ride a bike, how to kick a ball, it's for all your life.
Not for me, mate. I've lost it. It's all gone.
Nobody forgets rock and roll.
Oh, this was funny, doing this.
He was very game, Eric. He
certainly was,
He did learn to rock and roll. You don't see too much of it, but he could certainly do it.
Football. Tell us about Fergie at Old Trafford, is it?
Pas français. There is no such world as cant. Let's dance.
Let's dance?
I'm the girl, come on.
You're the girl? Whoa, fucking hang on a minute now, mate. I think you've got the wrong end of the stick here. Whoa, that's just a step too far now. Right, that's it. What the fuck? It's really sending himself up there, isn't it? Well, you can do anything, but then you open my balloon space shoe. Well, you can knock me down, step in my face, slander my name all over the place. Well, do anything that you want to do, but I'm honey, lay off. And then we shot this bit late. I was knackered after this because I had to dance with the young Lille, older Lille, and Eric.
Yes, young Lille was played by Laura, who was a really good match for Stephanie.
You know what? You're smoking too much of this shit, you know. It's gonna have to stop.
Woman. Ah, les femmes. C'est le plus grand mystère des hommes.
She works part-time, so she can help her mum. Help Sam. She does baby massage. Same at the old folks' home. She just nourishes everything she touches. Well, she told me. You caused me to change, Eric.
There's another one that Paul threw in then. And you said to me, ask her, does she ever get lonely? Mm. And she come back, no, I'll take a lover sometimes. It's like, oh, my God, that hurt.
Mm. Oh, you got to tell me now, Lily, come on.
About once every 3 months, I go in the net and I'll pick out a little bed and breakfast. You know, by a river or maybe a nice walk, even by the sea sometimes or a little church. And then I just up and I go. Never the same place, so it's always a little adventure.
Sounds great.
Yeah.
But do you not get a bit lonely when you go to these places, though?
No. Sometimes take a lover.
Oh.
Shocked.
Well, I suppose it's inevitable, really, isn't it?
Probablement, some lean, shy, athletic foreign student fascinated by a macho woman with gentle hands.
Fucking hell, mate. I was hoping it was some bald bastard from Bolton. Fucking hell.
is a yours.
Jesus Christ, I don't believe it. In blue suede shoes?
I had a bonfire in the back garden one night. Went round the house and I gathered absolutely everything that belonged to you. Come to throwing them on and well, I just couldn't do it.
Thank God for that. Hey, that was a good night. You know what? It was the best night.
I like this woman. I like this woman a lot. She has a big balls. Big balls, Eric, you know?
Yeah, well, one day she's going to look me straight in the eye and not feel sorry for me. That's all I want.
Personal trainer. New regime, day one.
What?
I needed a couple of Radox baths after this day, I'll tell you that. Don't know how many takes we did, but it was like, I was aching. I mean, trying to keep up with Eric was bad enough as it was. Nearly jumped as high as him.
Jump up. There we go. Hey! What are you doing?
The A team again.
Hey! What are you doing? What's he look like I'm doing?
We never got the three-legged dog in, did you, Ken?
No, no.
A shame that, because you got two of them in it, didn't you, at one point? Mm.
There was a shot of a three-legged dog walking past the training duo on the far side, but unfortunately didn't make the final cut.
Mm.
Anyway, he's there in spirit, hopping along.
Yeah, yeah. At the beginning of the fight back.
Yes.
Right, I'm having it cleared out, right? There's far too much shit in this house for a start. Too many TVs. So we're having it cleared out of tellies. Telly number one in here, lads.
Right, here we go.
There's a bit of rhyming slang just there. What's the Bobby Moore? I hadn't heard that for What's the Score.
Right.
What's going on here?
What are you doing?
Is that Maureen from the mini-mart?
Eric, get out.
Is that Maureen from the mini-mart?
It's called Shaving Ryan's Privates. Hey, Ryan.
Eric, can you fuck off, please? Just chilling.
Tell your dad to fuck
off. We did think about casting Maureen from the mini-mart after that scene, but there were too many people wanted to attend the audition, so we didn't.
You're not taking my telly. That's my telly. I got that for you.
I stole that for you, Dad. That's just how much I think of you.
That's my telly. You're not taking. I brought that for you.
Cheers, lads.
What are you taking it for?
Please go and get the one in the kitchen. And there's one in Ryan's room, one in Jess's room.
Don't even think about going in my room.
Leave the one in my room, eh, lads.
Don't.
Thanks a lot.
Leave the one in your room. What are you doing? Why are you taking my telly?
That smells good, Dad.
Oh, it is. Lovely.
What is it?
Steak, chips, peas, carrots and gravy.
And this got cut down as well because Jess ended up stealing the food and running upstairs and locking himself in the bathroom and eating it, which is quite funny.
Is that plates?
Oh, didn't I tell you, lads? Oh, sorry, I forgot. New rules. No work, no food.
What? I've been waiting for this. I ain't eaten all day.
So? Oh, yeah.
Play your games, Eric. I'm not asked.
Good. Because it makes me feel right.
Yeah, I hope it does, because you don't have a clue. Fucking man, you twat. I hope you're choking it, you cunt.
Oh, lost your bottle again, Eric. Come on, lad.
Yeah, that was me, Lily.
Oh. And? What did you want?
Christ, I forgot what I was going to ask you.
So you thought you'd put the phone down on me?
Oh, no, I was just wondering if you'd like to come round at the weekend, you know, for a bite to eat. Sam can come as well, you know, when she's finished. Only if you want to, like, and you've got an out on, you know, if you're not in the Lake District at a B&B with your young athletic lover having a shag.
Very funny, Eric.
I didn't mean it like that, Lily.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd like that, Eric. I must warn you, I'm a vegetarian now, though.
Okay, yeah, no problem.
That's great.
See you, bye.
Result. Nice one, Eric. You're getting there, lad, even though you nearly put your foot in it again then. So we celebrate with a nice last spliff. That was another lovely little surprise, because when we framed that shot up, the Tupperware tub was there full of weed, and when we went for the take, it was been replaced by a gun.
And we've had a bit of criticism from one or two reviewers. Saying that the dark turn the film takes now is really out of keeping with the rest of it.
Mm.
We thought about this, obviously, very carefully. But I think the reality is for Ryan and Jess that this is the world that they're born into, and that there will be bad things like this possibly happening. And just to make the trouble that Ryan is in too trivial just seemed to us to undermine the film, that it has to be quite serious.
I don't care.
And so the dark turn we felt was justified. But it is a difficult balance to pull off, really. I mean, we don't need to remind ourselves just how serious gun crime is, among young people particularly.
Well, it's every week someone's getting shot, and some young lad. Mm.
Fuck. You looking for this? Think. It's a fucking gun, Ryan.
What are you doing in my room? It's none of your fucking business.
This is my house. It is my fucking business.
Eric, you don't know what's going on.
Well, you better fucking tell me then.
If I don't get that to him, yeah, I'm in the shit. We all are.
You better go and tell him to fuck off. Or I will, all right? Hey, you're not fucking having it, Ryan. Fuck off.
Fucking gun, Eric.
No. Fuck. Fucking
got an expert! Yeah, it is shocking, this. I mean...
You're going fucking nowhere!
Help me!
You're going fucking nowhere!
What
fucking nowhere!
Get
out! Fuck off! You're going fucking...
Hey,
bastard!
I mean, Ryan's driven by fear here.
Yeah.
Not a need to be violent to his dad, but just driven by fear. And I think lads like him are very vulnerable and very susceptible to be frightened.
He said I could use his car, get round to his house, get the fucking keys off him, get back here as quick as you can.
Oh, Dad, I'm not leaving like this.
Just go on, I can't go down. If Meatball's serious, he'll freak. Go on, Jess will be all right.
Dad, I'll be quick, yeah?
Yeah, quick as you can, lad. Thank you.
And me and Jess were really worried this night because we were driving round and we didn't know. We thought we were going to find a dead body and it was going to be Ryan, you know. So we really didn't know what was where he was going to go, what was going to happen next. And again, quite exciting way to work. But we really were feared that we were going to come across this dead body and it was going to be the stepson.
Fucking ambulance there as well.
Trying to have a fucking look. There's someone going in the fucking ambulance, man. Can you see that, Jess? Fucking have a look. For fuck's sake.
I can't see him, Dad. There's no one in the fucking ambulance. The camera work by Barry Aykroyd is I think his operating was particularly good in that sequence, just going from the close-up in the car to the action outside. Those scenes are quite difficult to shoot because you're crammed together in the back of the car. And personally, I always feel that shots where you look through the windscreen and hear people talk, or the camera is in front of the people in the front of the car, is unrealistic because it's an impossible position for anyone to be in. So we shoot scenes from the rear of the car looking across, and which makes it very cramped, but I think more realistic. But the way Barry moved from the people in the car to what they're seeing to back, the way he lit it, I think was not something you would recognise when you're watching it because you just want to see the action. But when you think about it, he really worked it very well.
I love this scene, mate. I think there's so much tension in this because Eric Bishop, don't know, if he starts shouting at him, he's just straight out the door, isn't there? And it's...
First he told me it was just a fake.
We find out how cruel Zach is.
Just hiding it. Just hiding it. Someone else just pulls the trigger. And some kid just gets his head blown off.
I didn't think that were going to happen. Zach asked me to do it as a favour, just for one night.
Did he pay you?
Sorry, it brought me to the games, nightclubs. Gave me £200. After a week, I told him, I don't want to look after it anymore, but he just shook his head and started laughing.
Why doesn't he hold it?
Back to prison if he gets caught, but he needs it close and he can get it from me in 5 minutes.
And if you get caught?
At 5 years, Eric, minimum.
Fuck, Ryan! That's 5 years of your life, you fucking prick!
He shot someone.
It's interesting when you cut a scene like this because there are all kinds of choices on how you balance it between the two characters. And one case in point was that when Eric lets fly out of anger and frustration at Ryan there, we cut it with that line, shouted line at on Eric, but on balance it just became too much. And then we cut it the other way with with Eric off screen and just seeing the effect of the shouting on Ryan. And that seemed to work better, the balance seemed to work better. But the choices throughout doing any scenes, there are so many choices you can make. And the balance of that is one of the interesting parts of cutting. which Jonathan Morris carries out with great delicacy.
I've got to speak to him.
You can't speak to him. He's not like you or your mates. They don't give a fuck.
Look, we can't fucking live like this. We can't go to the cops.
The other interesting choice, again, choices that you have to make are just the position of the camera. And again, it's a very small space. And Barry and I found that the simplest, the most economical way of doing it was really you have one camera position almost throughout the scene, which is in the corner of the camera is now. And practically everything is seen from that point of view, which I hope gives it the sense of being observed rather than the camera darting around all over the place. It also makes it much quicker to shoot, and the quicker you can shoot it, the more you can keep the rhythm of the performances constant. Because there's a lot of delays between shots, then of course the actors lose the impetus, lose the sense of playing off their instinct, which is really, as a director, is what you want. There's a nasty surprise for Eric in this scene as well.
Yeah, another one that I didn't know about.
The fruitcakes and the loonies and all that. Nasty rumours, them, Jack.
Which was great, because when I think I got the scene the night before and it wasn't complete, and I knew something had happened, but I didn't know what. So I was quite worried and I couldn't sleep properly because I knew something was going to happen. And if I was doing this in real life with a local psychopathic gangster, I would have been worried about meeting up with him. So it worked on that level as well.
You're going to fuck off home with your tail between your fucking legs, up the carpet, up the floorboard, and you're going to pop that back. Yes, yeah, you fucking are.
I can't. Listen, if you don't want it right, I'll just throw it away and that's the end of it.
Throw it away, will you?
Yeah.
Yeah, Buzz. Come on, Buzz, let's have you.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
Oh, fuck off.
You fucking idiot.
Go on. Go on, boy. Let me out, you bastard.
Fuck off.
Fucking
hell.
Go on. Let me out, you bastard.
Get him.
Fuck off.
Fuck off.
Fuck
off.
Dad.
Interesting, he called him Dad then.
When you're filming, there's all kind of little serendipitous things happen. One baby was in because they were twins, and for the early part, and then he got quite sleepy. And there is a moment when which you could never get by planning it, but the baby fades to black. The shutters come down.
I'll tell you what, Jess,
wow.
It does look nice, lad.
It
does.
That looks gorgeous.
What's
that?
Uncle
Jess's bed, yes?
Yeah, it's getting sleepy.
Yeah, fading. And we all love shooting this scene, because I remember we broke for lunch after this, because when we were going back to unit base, we were saying, oh, it was a lovely little scene, that nice little domestic scene with them all sort of playing happy families. So we were quite chuffed with that.
Tell you what, love.
And of course we should have known, shouldn't we? The calm before the storm, so to speak.
There's the baby.
Yeah, zoning out. Ah. So this is when we'd come back from lunch now, and we shot this scene in the kitchen, me and Lily. And the other actors are still in the living room, still sat around that table, eating, and just still being in the scene, if you like. Just not in front of camera. Mm-hmm.
I think this is a very good scene for Lily, because she knows there's something going off with the boys, but and she really gives him the chance to really be mature and and talk. So, her offering to talk is really quite a big gesture on her part, because if he were to take it, then that could lead on to a stronger relationship again. So it's there's quite a lot at stake.
Mm-hmm. And again, she just does it so naturally and lovely, you know, so gentle.
Do you know what, Eric? Sometimes you just have to risk it, share things.
I'll get there. How's your coffee?
But of course, if Eric were to say it, then to say what's happening, then the responsibility it places on Lily is too much. So in a sense, he's right not to say.
Now, this was frightening, yeah. After having such a lovely morning and in the living room eating, and then that lovely little tender scene between Eric and Lily, to go to this.
We had to persuade not the police not to be too pally beforehand, so we kept them separate so that nobody knew they were there.
Yeah, we didn't know they were there. It must have been a logistics nightmare, because there was about 40 of them, wasn't there? And we never saw any of them.
No,
it only
seemed like 40, I think.
Oh, did it?
I think
there were
about 8 or 9.
Really?
Yeah. The few days before we did this scene, there had been a police raid like this onto the wrong house in Bolton, and there was a mistake acknowledged, I think, that an elderly woman had been raided by the police in that way, either on the lookout for a weapon or for some other reason, and it was the wrong house.
I think Lucy Jo was really crying there.
Yes, no, she did very well.
She did very well not to have a heart attack.
I think a lot of acting is having a positive, something positive to respond to, that if you had to generate that from nothing, it would be very hard. So I think having a really strong impact to respond to is just makes it a bit easier.
Well, yeah, it certainly helps. It.
Oh, don't be daft.
Look at me. Is there a gun in the house? If you invited me, Daisy.
Again, Barry Ackroyd's camera work is very thoughtful here, because he it's really just done in one shot, and judging the moment to go from one to the other is done with great delicacy by the cameraman.
Now, what really happened to
you,
Eric?
To me, I told you what happened, Lily. It's a nutter on the poster. Just date me, I told you.
We've got your daughter and grandchild in the police car outside. We're going to take them up. If you want to follow me, we'll take you right now, OK?
Okay.
We shot a whole scene where the police were searching the house, but in fact, when we came to put the film together, although it was done very expertly by people who knew what they were doing, the scene was superfluous to the storytelling.
They've lifted the floorboards. Where's it gone?
That's a good question.
The lads didn't know where the gun was at this point.
You surprised?
Eric, you fucking beauty.
Hey, you surprised, eh?
Very surprised.
Oh, so was a fucking chicken.
Yes, Dad!
Hey, I'm not great loving a chicken, but I love this one.
Oh, God.
Put it on loudspeaker. Put it on.
Yeah, it's me.
Have they gone?
Yeah, how the fuck do you know?
Yeah, still got it.
Good. Right, this calls for a bit of a bonus then, eh? Do you hear me?
Yeah.
Good. I'm gonna need it soon. Very fucking soon.
So what are you gonna do now then, eh, Ryan? Let that fucker shoot another kid in the back for laughing at his shirt or something, then stick it under your bed for him, eh? Fucking ruining other people's lives.
For the police to raid a house, obviously they've got to have very strong information from a reliable source. So we'd assumed that Zach had a contact who would have been able to be that reliable source.
What fucking now?
What's that about? Put a video on you on YouTube.
It's probably on fucking YouTube.
What do you think? If you ever have a look.
A fucking twat with a camera. That's why I fucking twatted that camera. I'm sat there with my two sons, right? And I'm looking at myself being humiliated, and it was like being out of my body again, looking down on myself yet again being humiliated.
The character Fenner, who took these pictures, played by Ryan Pope, and that's his camera work. You see, not bad.
Yeah, he's quite good, isn't he, Fenner?
Mm-hmm. Toujours plus de choix qu'on pense. Always got more choices than we think. Always. More possibilities.
Well, not another shave. I've done that.
Different possibilities, different thing. You try something, it doesn't work. Try something else, always.
Like what?
The philosophy of the football pitch applied to life here again.
I couldn't even begin to think about telling me mates. I mean, where do I start? Have you got a minute, lads? Yeah, it's about my lad. He's minding a gun for the local psychopath who shoots kids in the back if they laugh at the colour of his shoes. I mean, God, I'm just too ashamed. I don't know what they'd think.
Are your friends, are they?
Yeah, they're my mates, yeah.
Do you think you can say everything to your friends?
Yeah, I suppose you can, yeah.
So trust them.
It just looks so cool, Eric, doesn't it? I've done
in his house and fallen the fucking dibble.
What, in his house?
You can't do that because you've
been... Why can't you do that?
Because his house is over.
Yeah. The only thing you can do is phone the police.
Out of the question.
There's a gun in your house!
Shut up!
Is that the answer?
Stop running out at Lynch.
Meatballs.
Meatballs.
Alright,
mate.
Psychos.
Another book.
They don't give a flying fuck.
You know that.
That's the latest research from Stanford.
You can't negotiate with them, you can't reason with them, right? You've just got to fuck them up, you've got to scare the shite out of them. You've got to make them think this is not fucking worth it.
They're big gang of thugs, aren't they? Gang of, I mean, like, they got muscles coming out of their arse, aren't they? And they got guns. And baseball bats.
I don't care about...
They must dread meatballs turning up at the local library, you know. What's he after this week?
Yeah, get the pan better.
Right, OK. Oh, just a same again, you know.
I think it's something that's very undervalued in films, really. It's just is the crack from a gang of people who know each other well, usually at work, and that interplay between a group of people is very undervalued in films.
What are you doing?
I think.
That was tight of Paul, wasn't it?
You see, he asked him to... Paul wrote that line knowing that Eric would have difficulty saying it.
He sows thistles, reaps prickles.
THs, he knew he'd have a problem with, so he put it in very, very underhand.
Is that strongly on the left? You go right. Remember?
Yeah.
But not to raise. Surprise them. Got to surprise yourself first.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Fuck yeah.
Here
you go, Ryan.
Nice
drinks.
Right, yeah. Cheers. Listen, stick the rest of them on the bar there.
A couple of FC United lads there, just behind Eric Bishop.
Here we are.
Yes,
aye.
Good man.
You want some? You got them all, eh?
Yeah, get them.
Here you go.
Right.
No,
it's
yours. Lager, bitter.
You're on bitter, aren't you?
Right, listen. What is he frightened of? Explain. What's he frightened of?
Gangsters, other gangsters,
no.
Police.
No.
His nana?
No.
Not fuck out of me. What? I'm not smiling this despite you.
Unions?
No.
Go on, what?
Give me a clue.
Losing face. He's frightened of losing face, isn't he? Think about it. Fucking wide boy like him.
That's what I was saying.
So we could think of some way of embarrassing him, like.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's psychic.
Showing him up?
Yeah, something like that.
YouTube.
What? YouTube.
YouTube.
What the fuck? Is that a new kind of
blue cream? No, he's right. He's fucking right. YouTube. When's the next away match?
This was good fun to do as well, wasn't it? There's three coachloads of them.
Okay, here we go. It's the East Lancs A580 directly to Worsley Road. Take the left turn onto A572 for a rendezvous ETA 1200.
Spleen gets kitted out in military gear
and he's walking talkies.
Just to make it more efficient.
Where are you? I have lost radio contact.
Yeah, trying to maintain some kind of control there.
Where are Meatballs? Where are you? For fuck's sake! This is going to cock. This has all been planned. Where's Coach 2? Where is it?
Yeah.
Yeah, where's Coach 2? Where is it? Oh, what the fucking hell's going on?
You must have the fucking Yanks in Baghdad, you.
What the fuck is going on here?
Hey.
What are you doing?
And you no need to give them instructions there. When two coach loads of football fans pass each other, they all just do that.
Okay, maintain convoy, stay back. Come on, let's sort this out now. Stop fucking about. You know what you need to do. We need to get in and out and get that job done. We've got 45 minutes. We don't want to miss kickoff. Are we all right for it?
Yeah!
We all up for it?
Yes!
Operation Cantona!
Yeah! What a friend we have in Jesus. He's our saviour from afar. What a friend we have in Jesus. And his name is Cantona.
But the guy who owned that house, he was going to knock it down anyway,
yes,
wasn't
it? The house we shot in.
So it basically
was to be demolished.
Do what you want with it.
Yes, it was demolished to an extent.
These lot were well buzzing here.
Mm.
Look at Doyle there, Boyle jumping up and down. He does the songs.
How big is it?
Fucking big.
Big, it's fucking big. Should have brought some steak. Give us some sausages.
Yeah.
For fuck's sake.
Come on, get in.
It's here. Fucking hell, look at the size
of that. Shut up.
You big ugly, get in the loop.
Come on.
Come on, you're going to have my fucking hand up.
Here.
Right. Come on.
Get the fuck up.
Go on.
I post special delivery.
Come on. Hey. Right, Sonny, get a little dog. Okay, man. Operation Cantona. Express yourselves.
What a completely surreal sight. When we ran in and turned round and saw all them coming in, I remember just laughing my head off.
Again, we got taken to task by some of the more serious-minded reviewers that saying that it was an incredible scene, but maybe there weren't two things in the film that aren't strictly realistic, but it does nevertheless present Zach with a serious dilemma, because if he's he would face ridicule, which is and his whole credibility is based on not being ridiculed.
Yeah, yeah.
If this were to come out, which will be Meatball's threat.
Yeah.
So I think the dilemma is real enough, really, and the number of people who are there are not something he can dismiss. We know he's got no weapons on the premises. The dog's been neutralised. He's there with a couple of his pal and a couple of girls. So he is, at that moment, he is quite vulnerable.
You
fucking bastard,
and then this little cunt here.
You recognise that?
Give a fuck.
Hey, you fucking dare, it's yours. Hey.
What are you fucking, you're talking shit, you prick. All of you, fucking come on.
Right, boys, fire off.
Get off! You fucking
dick! Hey,
fuck off! Come on, that's your walking joke!
Hey!
Fuck off!
Hey!
Is this it?
Get off! Yeah, I think a few people got a bit carried away in here as well, didn't they?
They did.
What do you want? What do you fucking want?
Sir, you recognise it?
It's a fucking gun. There's hundreds of them. Oh, fucking nice one.
Yeah.
Fucking
nice one. Hey, acknowledge it now.
Get out of me. No, it's a fucking gun. No, I've never fucking seen it.
Boom.
Get to fuck. Fuck. Leave it out.
Do you recognise it?
Fuck off.
Right, boys.
Like a bird in hand on a Saturday night.
Hey! Hold it, fucker! Hold it! Right! All right, boys! To court! Get back!
You fucker. What? Yeah, all right, fast, Eric. I've fucking seen it.
And?
Will you fucking win?
You got that, boys? Sure. Ladies and gentlemen, before your very eyes, I am going to smash this bleeding gun in a smithereens.
Whoa, not the fucking tiles. They're Italian, then.
Are you Italian?
Yeah. You fucking twat. You fucking cunt. Fucking pack it in!
Go on. Yes! Go on! Yes. Go on. Go on. You know that family. You don't go near them. You don't look at them. You don't talk to him, you don't even think about him. Because you know what'll happen? Come on, tosspot, I thought you could tell the future. Well, let me tell me your future. Hey, we're going to turn up here with 10 coach loads and we're going to take this house apart brick by fucking brick. Hey? And this little movie that you've been starring in with your little mate, hey? One word to Ryan and it's going to be on Bluetooth.
It's YouTube. It's called YouTube.
Well, whatever it is, you're going to be on it with your fucking poncy posing pouch and your gimp of a mate and all the people laughing at your little red willy. You fancy that, do you? Hey? And if you try and run away to some porthole in Blackpool or some rabbit hole in the Outer Hebrides, we'll find you. I'll find you. You know why? Because I'm a fucking postman!
That always gets a great laugh, that line.
Yes, it's a great message of support to postmen everywhere, just at the time the government are trying to sell it off. Never mind.
Get on, boys, well done. Come on, let's get in the match, eh? Let's get a few beers.
Oh, man. Hey, Eric. Thanks so much, mate.
I'm here for it.
Do you know what I mean? I was done in, and then, like, you sorted all that out, and, like,
right.
I'm sorry as well, do you know? Like,
listen,
thanks,
trouble
thanks,
no more.
Thanks, Eric.
Thanks, man.
Have you spoke to Lily?
Yeah, she's not returned the calls, is she? You've got to speak to her.
Tell her, just tell her what happened in that and she'll understand.
Listen, that's all fixed with Harry. She's had enough. You know what?
can't say I blame her, really.
Yeah, but she hasn't had enough. If she knows about what I did now, you won't
help. Leave it.
Whip you up. Come on,
get it. I will.
Come on, Captain, are you, don't you get? I hope you haven't been robbing. Come on, we're going to miss the match.
It's interesting how music can knit scenes together that without it will can seem quite disjointed, but George's music in a way tells you what's being said without having to spell it out in dialogue. This was the last day of shooting, and one of the hardest days for some reason. The two babies were were struggling, and I was struggling even more. And the light was going, and it was even at one stage I thought we're just not going to get the scene in.
But, and we had the rap party that evening as well, didn't
yes,
we?
Yes, yes.
I don't know how we got to it.
It's said that comedy is tragedy with a happy ending, and this set of characters and these dilemmas could have ended tragically. It could have been a kind of an emotional drama. There were all kinds of possibilities with this group of characters.
I'll give you that. And you know, them boys, they love you to pieces. So does Sam. You must have done something right, eh?
I want to take a picture of Mum and Dad. Mum, Dad, come on. Your turn now.
No, it's all right.
I think they look great together, Eric and Lily Bishop.
Yeah, come on. Come on, be all right. Where's you want us?
In the middle.
Is that all right? Shall I have some acid?
Yeah.
Press that.
Just press that.
All right.
Okay.
Nice one.
Dad, what the hell have you got on your feet?
Shoes.
You kidding? You think I didn't notice, you lunatic?
Lunatic? What?
Quite daring, that little touch around the waist there, with Eric.
Well, I guess the touch around the waist is a sign that he's really he's really made progress.
That's right.
And George writes one of the happiest pieces of music he's ever written for us for the credits.
It's nice to end it with this.
When the seagulls follow the trawler, it's because they think sardines will be thrown into the sea. Thank you very much.
How cool is that? Just saying that and walking out.
Thank you.
Contrary to expectation, this fine trumpet solo is not by Eric Cantona, but by Mike Lovett. I think Eric might have had a few more bum notes.